Welcome to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast, the official podcast of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. We are talking hunting, fishing, and conservation with engaging guests and in-depth discussions with game and fish staff. It's Arkansas Wildlife, the podcast for all things outdoors in the natural state.
Welcome to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast, the official podcast of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. My name is Trey Reid. I am the host of the podcast and Assistant Chief of Communications here at Game and Fish, and really appreciate everybody listening in to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast. It is springtime, finally. The dogwoods are blooming. The trees are turning green. The days are getting longer. The temperatures are getting warmer, and water temperatures are getting warmer, and that brings the fish to the banks, and that's why springtime is prime time for fishing in Arkansas. And the most popular fish in our waters is the black bass. We've got three species of those here in Arkansas: the largemouth, the smallmouth, and the spotted bass. And today we are joined by a couple of guys from the Game and Fish Commission's Fisheries Division who are in the know, and we're going to be talking all about bass fishing and bass management here in the natural state. Joined by Sean Lusk, staff biologist in the Fisheries Division. Sean, welcome to the podcast. How's it going, man?
It's going pretty good. Thanks for having me on.
Well, thanks for coming in to talk about fishing. And Jeremy Risley, been with the Game and Fish Commission for 18 years, but just recently changed jobs. Jeremy is now our black bass program coordinator. He is the bass biologist for the whole state. Jeremy, welcome aboard, man.
Thanks for having me.
Well, neither of you guys are strangers to fishing. You both do a lot of fishing. You both do a lot of fisheries management. So let's jump right into it. The black bass, the most popular fish probably in the country, definitely in the southeastern United States. And our surveys tell us the most popular fish in Arkansas waters. Got a lot going on with bass management. Namely, I'd say let's start with the black bass management plan, the reservoir bass management plan, which is we've had management plans before, but this was sort of a new way of approaching it. Sean, let's start with you. Kind of tell us about this plan and where it is with the new plan. It's kind of starting the implementation phase after a whole lot of planning. Where do we sit with it now?
Yeah, so you almost got to rewind a little bit and look at where the black bass plans kind of come from. So this is the third iteration of the black bass plan. The first one was largely focused on looking at regulations. You know, how can we go out and implement different regulations on these black bass populations? The second one really focused on evaluating population dynamics, so looking at growth and mortality and recruitment. And as we've gone through these plans, we've learned a tremendous amount. And so the main focus on this plan was taking it to the next level and really getting a lot of stakeholder input, okay? Really working with stakeholders to direct where the actual management plan goes. So Jeremy was actually on the black bass species management team, and what they did was they developed a committee full of people that are really invested in black bass fishing across the state. And it was a mix of anglers and individuals with state parks and a really good variety of people. Got them together and worked with them to really direct where the management plan is actually going. And so it's officially into effect now, and Jeremy has really hit the ground running. He's got a roadmap for the next 10 years of his career where he's got a series of goals and objectives that are going to guide where the black bass plan goes moving forward.
Jeremy, you're an avid bass angler yourself. I fished with you up on Bull Shoals. It's been a few years. We need to do that again sometime soon. What was that like for you coming in? You know, you've been in fisheries management a long time, but it's kind of bass anglers typically are pretty vocal. They like to make their opinions known, particularly on social media these days. And, you know, getting back to what Sean said about tailoring a management plan that you know, meets kind of, you know, diverse interest and diverse fisheries. What's that challenge like for you?
Yeah.
Did they have to come up to Mountain Home and, like, you know, restrain you and bring you down and force you to become the black bass biologist?
No. I first of all, I feel like it's a great honor. Like you said, I've been bass fishing all my life, and that's my hobby and my passion. Like I tell everybody, I became a biologist to support my fishing habit. So, but yeah, we felt like that having the stakeholder input at the beginning was vital to the success of the plan. And we tried to ensure that we just didn't have a stakeholder committee full of tournament bass anglers. You know, often those are the most vocal. You know, as a tournament angler, we like to have our opinions known among everybody. But we tried to ensure that we had interest from the industry. You know, Arkansas is full with tackle companies, boat companies.
Absolutely.
You know, so we had that huge interest. And then we also had non-tournament anglers, and we had kayak anglers. And then we even had a person that does not even fish on there, but that person was invested in bringing tournaments to Arkansas. So, you know, we tried to ensure that we had a wide range of stakeholders within that committee to ensure that all voices were being heard in that plan.
Yeah, that's a little bit different from some of the previous iterations of the plan. Like you talked about, it's been like basically sort of an internal group, probably a Game and Fish, and you develop the plan and then put it out for comment, but you got the comment more on the front end.
Yes.
And then sort of tailored it and adapted it as we went along.
Yeah. So we used those, the stakeholders, to basically develop the plan. And then we came up with the tools to be able to accomplish what they felt like the direction we should be taking.
What is the biggest challenge to managing bass in Arkansas? And I throw the question, and I should probably have prefaced it with this. I mean, I think one of the great things about bass fishing in Arkansas is the diversity of water we've got. You know, you've everything from the Mississippi River and the slow moving bios in the Delta, and you know, lowland reservoirs up to the big clear water reservoirs like Beaver and Bull Shoals and Washita, Greer's Ferry, and the Game and Fish Lakes. I mean, it seems like it might be a little bit of a double-edged sword. I mean, that diversity, I think, is why a lot of people, you know, Arkansans have had a great amount of success in professional tournament bass fishing over the years. And that's one of the reasons it's always cited, is because we've got, you know, the Arkansas River and you've got the clear upland reservoirs. But it's not a one size fits all management approach, and I would imagine that's a bit of a challenge.
Big time.
Yep.
Well, let's get back to the question. What is, you know, if you had to look at, like, you know, the biggest challenge to managing bass in Arkansas, what is it?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest challenges we face is when you go to a boat ramp, you know, you go on a Saturday and you talk to 10 people and you say, describe your perfect bass fishery. You're going to get 10 completely different answers. You know, you'll have a guy that he wants to go out. He doesn't really care about, you know, any size. He wants to go and he wants to put his grandson on 10 bass. Okay. And then you talk to the next guy and, he's fishing by himself and he wants to go out and he wants to catch a limit of fish that he can take home and flay. And then a couple tournament guys come in and they only want to catch 5 fish and they want them all to be over 5 pounds. And when it comes to just that scenario, the way that you would manage the fishery for the first guy is different than you would manage it for the second guy, which is different than you would manage it for the third guy. You know, so it's really difficult just figuring out exactly what tools do we need to use in our toolbox to get this fishery where it's going to be to really maximize angler satisfaction.
So I'm sorry, go ahead, John. I didn't mean to interrupt.
No. And that's, I think that was the value of the way we set up the plan. You know, we worked with all this really diverse group of anglers to say, yeah, we need to have some fisheries that are specifically designed where people can go out and catch a lot of fish. And there needs to be lakes where people are going to go out and they're probably only going to have a couple bites a day, but those bites are going to be really, really good fish, you know.
So are we headed to a scenario, a future for bass fishing in Arkansas where different bodies of water are managed differently? I mean, like, where, you know, if I'm a guy that wants to go catch 10, you know, pound and a half bass to, you know, take my kids out or to take home to eat, am I going to go to a different place from where I, you know, might catch, you know, a 20 pound 5 fish limit? Or how does that work? What does that look like, I guess?
Yeah, so the plan does lay out that we will identify lakes that we feel like have the characteristics to be a trophy bass lake, and then those that maybe have high catch rates, so that if you're just wanting to go catch fish, then you would go to these lakes. And if you just want to catch trophy fish, you know, our management efforts are going to be geared toward growing big bass. So yes, there is that in the plan.
The next step is how do we get there? How do we achieve some of these different goals or objectives? What management strategies? What kind of research? I mean, how do we get to these goals?
Yeah, and you know that's another huge challenge that we face. You know, especially with our larger reservoirs. You know, the value of game and fish lakes is we control lake levels, we control productivity, we control what type of habitat is out there, we can control the fish community. If things get really bad, we can pull the plug and just start that sucker completely over.
Lower White Oak Lake,
a prime example. You know, we have that ability on these game and fish lakes. But when you get to these larger Corps of Engineer reservoirs, where we don't control water level, we don't control the buffer around the lake. They're so large, we really can't increase or decrease productivity, and we always have Mother Nature that's got a complete mind of her own. You know, one thing that we're working on right now is trying to reestablish aquatic vegetation in some of our larger core reservoirs in more of the mountainous regions of the state. And one of the brutalizers that we run into is if we deal with a situation when we get really high water in the late winter, right? You get this huge slug of really turbid water. You're not going to get the sunlight penetration that you need getting to the bottom to actually get aquatic vegetation growing. And on the flip side of that, if you get into the late summer time frame, you know, you don't get a lot of inflows from rain. You get a lot of hydroelectric power generation, and that water level drops. You may have had some aquatic vegetation growing, and now it's 30 yards up on the bank. It just got completely nuked. So then you're back to square one of trying to establish some sort of large scale habitat out there. So dealing with all these different variables, and you know, we have a good toolbox, but there are certain situations where we can't actually use the tools that are in that toolbox. So you know, you really have to start to think outside the box, get a little creative, and at the end of the day, you know, when it comes to dealing with environmental conditions, you need a little bit of luck on your side as well.
And you got to be adaptive. Depending on what you know. I mean, you've got to play the cards you're dealt.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's dive into that aquatic vegetation, because I know, Sean, that's something you've worked a lot on. We've done some stories on the Arkansas Wildlife Television show about the I hesitate to call on a pilot project, but it kind of is. On DeGray, working with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. DeGray was, you know, probably had too much vegetation at one point. Some people would say a certain interest of boaters.
Some people would.
Bass fishermen might disagree with that. It went away, and you've been working personally over there to get some of that reestablished. What does that look like? What's happening?
Yeah, so you know, back in 2009, yeah, there was quite a bit of aquatic vegetation down there. And then there was a series of environmental conditions and some other factors that contributed to a complete and utter disappearance of the aquatic vegetation down there. And we saw immediate effects on the fish community. And so what we've been trying to do is get vegetation reestablished down there. Because, you know, when it comes to habitat work, you know, there's building fish attractors, which may locally have an impact. And then there's more large scale things that you can do. And one of the, in my personal opinion, I'm sure Jeremy would agree with this, that some of the best fish habitat, especially for bass, is aquatic vegetation. It not only serves the fish early in life, giving them nursery cover, giving them a place to hide, but it also creates a lot of really good ambush predator or ambush points for those larger fish that we like to go out and catch. And so what we've tried to do over the last, gosh, we're getting into about 4 years now. It seems like we just got started on this, but
right.
We've dove off into this huge project trying to get aquatic vegetation reestablished onto Gray. And I'll be honest with you, starting off, I knew next to nothing about trying to, you know, get various types of native plants to actually grow, you know. So what we did was, every now and then you got to identify your shortcomings, right? And we reached out to the expert. We reached out to the people that this is what they do for a living. This is what they went to school for. This is what their job is. And fortunately, the Corps of Engineers has an experimental research and development center out of Lewisville, Texas, okay? And what they do is they take these systems that have had almost complete declines in habitat, and they find ways of restoring them naturally. So the biologist that we reached out to down there, her name was Lindy Dodd, and we brought her up to DeGray, and we basically said, give us a roadmap. You know, this is where the lake's at right now. You know, we went around, we threw a vegetation drag. We really didn't get anything. Told her that once upon a time, this thing was loaded with vegetation. How do we bring back a bunch of native aquatic vegetation? So she went back, took a month or two, and then she sent us this report. and it was a roadmap. And we took this thing to heart. Whatever she said to do, we did it. She said, create some greenhouses. We created some greenhouses. There were some greenhouses down at DeGray that we completely refurbished, and we started growing several different species of aquatic vegetation. And one of the really interesting things that they had in there was they had this thing called a tetrahedron. Okay, so if you think about the shape, a tetrahedron is like it's like a pyramid, like an elongated pyramid. And what you do is you get one of these things, you put a bunch of coontail in there, and then you let them float around, right? And then what they do is they essentially work like little pepper shakers. So as they're sitting there bobbing, you know, they're dropping all these little seeds, and you're basically seeding an area. And then you can move these enclosures around. Well, we couldn't figure out how we were going to make one of these things out of PVC. You know, like, how do you get the sides of that pyramid to come together? So we just decided to turn them into a cube and name them the Arkansas Cube. So essentially what they are these floating cubes that we fill with coontail. And then we've got them strategically located around a gray. And so we're going into our fourth year, and we're actually starting to see that around over half of the enclosures that we've put out, we've got 16 locations. There's coontail either growing directly below them or next to them. And we know that because Scott Jones with the University of Arkansas Pine Bluff has kind of taken it upon himself to do the evaluation component of this project, which is really cool. We've been able to see when we first started, there was no vegetation. And now around the majority of our sites, there is vegetation growing really close by.
I can verify as I went scuba diving on a couple of those sites and saw some little stems of coontail coming up.
Yeah.
It is pretty cool. And I bring that up because it was really pretty cool to drop down straight from that cage and didn't know what to expect.
Yep.
The water clarity was not very good. And so, I mean, I'm literally trying to find a needle in a haystack down there, but finally, like, oh yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
There it is. Very cool. There are bigger plans to expand that project to other parts of the state.
Yeah. And in my opinion, this is where it gets really exciting. So we've kind of done a little bit of proof of concept on DeGray. Okay. You can go down there. I can send you waypoints right now where you can go down on DeGray and you can find coontail, large stands of coontail. So there's actually a little bit of a pattern developing. But we really wanted to put this thing on steroids because, I mean, we are very passionate about, you know, habitat restoration. And so what we did was we had some funding come available, and we went back to Lindy and we said, okay, Lindy, we have some funding. Can we pay you for the next 4 years to basically turn this project into your baby? Okay, you're the expert in the field. You know exactly what's going on. Can you take what we've done on DeGray and basically put it on steroids and not only do it on DeGray, but expand the project to Greeson and Greer's Ferry as well? So diving into this year, we finally got all of our paperwork in place, which if you've never set up a research project with it's not easy, okay? It takes a long time, a lot longer than you might think. But we got all of our ducks in a row, and really soon Lindy's going to be going up to DeGray, and she's going to be doing a basic inventory of looking at our enclosures, making some modifications, and then identifying patterns of where the vegetation is actually growing. So we are starting to see a certain pattern at what depth it's growing at, and what type of substrates and like areas of the lake. And for the anglers that are listening, if you've been fishing out on the gray, I'm sure you've started to see a little bit of a pattern in where this stuff is actually growing.
You brought up earlier some, you know, Mother Nature controls a lot of this, and or the Corps of Engineers, and there are a lot of reasons they have to, you know, the lakes only hold so much water. Mm-hmm. They've got to evacuate it at some point. There's hydropower generation. There's a lot of variables that come into play. What kind of fluctuations have you seen over the 4 years on DeGray, and how does that factor into the success or failure?
I mean, honestly, if you could dial up, you know, ideal growing conditions for DeGray vegetation, we've had those over the last 3 years. You know, the lake has made, you know, you're going to have fluctuations in lake level with obviously spring inflows and hydroelectric power generation in the summertime. But we haven't had any just crazy, super high water events where, you know, the lake gets up and it's 20 feet high for a month, or the lake just bottoms out and we're getting near record like low lake levels. You know, it's stayed right in kind of this, right in this hot spot that we need to really, really encourage the plants to grow. And, you know, the fortunate thing is the conditions have been right and their plants have responded appropriately. So we're expecting, you know, going into this year, you know, again, we haven't had anything super crazy. It's been kind of a wet spring, but the lake hasn't just shot up and stayed up and just stayed super turbid. You know, we're expecting going into the growing season that conditions are looking really well for another good summer.
So looking ahead, Greeson and Greer's Ferry are a couple of other bodies of water where we're looking to expand this project.
Yeah.
Jeremy, I want to kind of turn to you now, talking about high water. You don't want it too high to cover up that vegetation that Sean and others in our fisheries division have been trying to get established on DeGray. But you, for many years, have Bull Shoals is not only your playground; it's your it's where you go to work too.
Yep.
And that is a lake that has been on kind of a hot streak for a decade or so because of high water. Explain how high water has helped things on Bull Shoals Lake and some of our other upland reservoirs.
Yeah, before doing so, I kind of want to hit on what Sean says. You got to have the perfect condition. So in the early 2000s, the Game and Fish actually tried to establish vegetation on Bull Shoals.
I was going
to
ask you about that because you were involved in that project.
Well, I was extra labor. So yeah, that was early in my career. But they spent a lot of time and the vegetation was actually starting to grow, and then it got 35 to 40 foot of water on top of it and it all disappeared. So, you know, that shows you the value of having stable water conditions while trying to get things established. When you get 35 foot of water on top of plants, they don't do too well.
Well,
but there's always the but part. But high water for these upland reservoirs like Beaver, Bull Shoals, Table Rock, Norfolk, even Greer's. Greer's right now has high water. They are huge benefits. And we have tons of data that shows if you have high water that lasts into summer or into early fall, that you see what we call large year classes or really high production of game fish and most importantly, bass. And for Bull Shoals and Norfolk, since 2010, we've had more high water events on those two reservoirs than from the day they closed the gates to 2010. So 60 plus years, in the last 12, 13, we've had more high water. So we're kind of in a unique situation. For Bull, it is making Bull show out. And on the other hand, we've actually had enough on Norfolk that we're starting to see some negative impacts of high water.
What are some of those negative impacts?
So we're seeing enough bass being produced that we're seeing decreases in growth. So our catch rates while we're sampling continue to go up, and to catch rates that we see on tailwaters for trout. I mean, we're seeing extremely high catch rates, but we're starting to see growth start to tail off now, and that's why we're trying to be proactive on Norfolk by changing the regulation that we did into this year to encourage some harvest of those really, really abundant 13, 14 inch bass that are out there so that we can encourage the remaining fish to grow how they once did.
It gets back into that. Talking about biomass, you can feed a whole bunch of smaller mouths or a fewer number of larger mouths, right?
Yeah. Across the South, you rarely see a reservoir that's known for having big bass that is also known for having high catch rates. It's either one or the other. You're either going to have or you catch few fish but they're really big, or you're going to catch a bunch and they're just going to be average size.
That brings up a great question, or I think it's a good question. How the catch and release ethic is so strong in bass fishing, despite the fact, as you mentioned, Sean, that some people want to go out there and catch fish and take them home and eat them, and there's nothing wrong with that. How do you get anglers, especially when that catch and release ethic is so ingrained, how do you encourage some harvest? I mean, I think there was a study out of Mississippi that I read a few years ago where they looked at, I think it was Ross Barnett Reservoir, and it had been managed under three different, it was over 30 years, like over basically roughly equal periods of 10 years, different, you know, slot limit, a minimum length limit. And I think they found that there was really not much difference between any of them because the vast majority of bass anglers were releasing their catch. How do you clear that obstacle, or how do you change the thinking of anglers to encourage some harvest, so you get rid of that, you know, some of those, you know, those, you diminish the numbers in those bigger classes like you're talking about.
Yeah, and I think that's a huge challenge for us, because, you know, for whatever reason, when it comes to like deer management, you know, folks realize, hey, you got to drop some does out there if you want big bucks, right? You just, a lot of people understand that, but it's the exact same thing when it comes to fishing. You know, you can have, you know, one 10 pounder, or you can have 10 1 pounders. You can't have both, right? Because there's only a finite amount of food out there. There's only so many groceries that are actually there, you know? And I think a lot of times people will go out and they'll catch a fish and they think to themselves, hey, I'm going to throw this fish back, and next time I come back, it's going to be larger. Well, probably not, you know, because it's competing with all those other fish that you just got done throwing back, you know. So the way our regulations work, you know, the way the North American model of fish and wildlife management functions is regulating harvest. Okay. And so if you don't have harvest, you can throw, like you mentioned, you can throw a minimum length limit on there. You can throw a slot limit on there. You can come up with any crazy combination of regulation. But if you don't actually have enough harvest to move the needle, then those regulations really don't work. And so as we've gotten toward, as this catch and release ethic, which there is, don't get me wrong, there is definitely a time and place for it. But as this catch and release ethic has gotten more popular, it's made the toolbox that we use to try to meet angler values, it's made it more difficult. Right, because when you have a lot of harvest out there, you can really restructure a population. But, you know, when people are throwing fish back, it makes it a lot more difficult.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's switch gears a little bit. We've been talking reservoir management. I want to talk about smallmouth a little bit, because it's my favorite of the Microptera species that we have here in Arkansas. We have recently, or in the midst of pretty substantial research project to learn more about our smallmouth bass. What can you tell me about that to enlighten our listeners?
Yeah, so we're currently working with the University of Arkansas to learn about the genetics of our smallmouth bass statewide. So our previous black bass biologist, he went around, he's the one that headed the project, but we collected fin clips from smallmouth bass all across Arkansas, streams, reservoirs, to understand what does our smallmouth bass genetics look like in the state. We currently know that there's at least three strains of smallmouth in the state. There's the Neosho, which is in northwest Arkansas and goes into Oklahoma. There's the Ouachita strain, smallmouth bass in the Ouachita Mountains, and then the northern smallmouth bass strain for the rest of the state. So we're trying to understand, the unique strains in the state, and then what does our genetics of our smallmouth bass look like in the state. And we also want to, this will also help us with understanding, do we have Alabama bass in the state, which Alabama bass in their native range get really big and are really cool, but outside of that native range, they are wreaking havoc on a unique strains of bass. So we're wanting to look at that as well.
Yeah, I mean, and we're still some months away from getting even initial preliminary genetic results, but what is the next step after that? I mean, what does that information allow us to do or know, or how does it affect management, I guess, down the road?
Yeah, I would say without a shadow of doubt, it comes down to, you know, what strains are we moving around? You know, if you look at the range of smallmouth, the very southern tip of smallmouth is in the Ouachita Mountains. It's that Ouachita Mountain strain. And when you've been running around the Ouachita Mountains before, you know, you run into these streams that get real skinny in the summer, you know, and you touch them and they're smoking hot, and you slip that rooster tail in there and you'll have a smallmouth come up and just crush it. Now, if you took a smallmouth out of Minnesota and threw it down the stream, it's not going to do well, right? and that comes down to their genetic makeup and how they metabolize and how they deal with these certain conditions. So the reason why that information is extremely important is, you know, we just started stocking Lake Catherine with smallmouth.
That was where I was going next.
You know, and one of the decisions that we had to make is, what smallmouth are we going to put in here? Okay, we have, Catherine's square in the middle of the Ouachita Mountains, right? What was in the Ouachita River before Catherine was impounded with was Washtenaw strain smallmouth. But, you know, we get a lot of anglers that say, hey, I go and I fish Pickwick all the time and I catch some Magnum smallmouth. That's what I want to see in Catherine, right? But, you know, and it's easy to think that, oh yeah, we go over here, we get them from this system where they grow really big and we put them over here and they do really well. But that's not necessarily the case, because a lot of folks don't realize we actually stocked Lake Washtenaw with Tennessee River or reservoir strain smallmouth bass, and they did not take, they did not do well at all whatsoever. So this kind of gave us the with the information that we have to start kind of putting pieces of the puzzle together on maybe why that didn't work and making informed management decisions moving down the road. You know, we have these fish are especially adapted for this area for the extremely hot summers that we get. We need to be using those strains. So where all do those exist, you know?
Yeah, you mentioned our previous bass biologist doing a lot of that research. We were able to go out and do some true single-line sampling with hook and line, trying to catch some fish for this genetic study, and it was August, late July or August last summer. I was stunned at the water temperature in some of these streams in southwestern Arkansas.
Yeah.
I mean, like, we're talking over 90 degrees. I wouldn't think a smallmouth could even survive in that.
No, and they do just fine. And so you don't want to run into a situation where you get genetics from fish that aren't adapted to those situations. They may get in there and they start spreading those genetics, right, with future generations of smallmouth that can't handle those heat, that those high water temperatures.
Right.
And then, you know, you go from a situation where you have this smoking hot stretch of stream where you can go there every single summer and catch fish, so now all of a sudden there's no more smallmouth that can actually live there. You know, when it comes to, you know, managing sport fish, you know, we've always got these grand visions of, you know, taking these fish over here that we know do really, really well and bringing them over here. And unfortunately, it doesn't always work like that. And you've got the potential to really, really mess things up for future generations. So having information like what we're collecting from this smallmouth, this big smallmouth project, is essential for helping us make informed management decisions to not only take care of our anglers now, but be thinking about that next generation and the generation after that.
All right. So I'm going to pose another question. We're getting back to largemouth now, and it would seem to contradict some of the things you just said, and I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but we've been working on Florida strain largemouth bass in Arkansas for a number of years. I know that's one thing anglers want. They grow mm-hmm. fast. They get big. They are sometimes aggressive. A lot of characteristics that anglers like. So why is that okay to do and not with the
yeah,
smallmouth?
And I think that's a fantastic question. And so there's a lot we don't actually know about the natural integrate zone of Florida largemouth bass. So I would say right now one of the leaders.
All right. I got to stop you. All right, the natural intergrade zone. Okay. Define that phrase for
okay.
me.
Okay, yeah. Thank you for stopping me there. Okay, so when you think of the natural, so you at this point you have two species. Okay, largemouth bass are a different species than Florida bass. Okay, now you have the natural range of largemouth bass, which is a lot of North America, okay, all the way from like southern Canada all the way down into Mexico. Then you have Florida bass, which their range is the peninsular part of Florida, okay? Now, there's not just a hard line, right, where this side of the river is largemouth, this side of the river is Florida bass. There's going to be some mixing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so where that natural integrate zone, and where that mixing happens is what I'm referring to as the integrate zone. Historically, that integrate zone was believed to be, you know, part of Florida, you know, some of Alabama going up into Georgia, just this really small area. But one of the leaders in a lot of Florida bass research right now is Auburn University, okay? And they have done a tremendous amount of looking at genetics of different largemouth across the country. Personally, we did a big study on Lake Washtenaw where we sent them 1,000 fin clips, okay? And we're just... That was one lake in one state. Okay, there's people doing that across the southeast right now. And so what they're finding is they're finding Florida alleles. Now, an allele is basically, you can think of that as Florida bass genetics. Okay, so what they're doing...
It's like a genetic marker, right?
Yeah. It's a... I don't want to get too genetic-y here, but yeah, it's a genetic marker. And so what they're finding is that natural integrate zone is a heck of a lot larger than we originally thought, okay? Just there's the presence of Florida genetics are so prolific throughout the Southeast that they're believing that that integrated zone is not as contained as it once was, that there's potential that it went a lot farther north and west than they originally thought. So the idea of us being the first ones to bring Florida alleles to the state of Arkansas is still a big question mark.
They may have already been here.
There's some speculation that, you know, and, you know, at this point it becomes very, very difficult because there has been a tremendous amount of stalking. You know, back, you know, in the 50s when we identified that, hey, these bass down here in Florida grow really big and their genetics are slightly different than these bass that we get all over the rest of the country. Well, hey, what if we take some of those and put them over here? You know, that's been going on forever, not only on, you know, with state agencies, but I mean, stocking Florida bass, especially F1s, you know, that first generation cross between a largemouth and a Florida bass, is extremely popular. So, I mean, these fish have been moved everywhere for extended periods of time. So it makes it very difficult to go back and say, hey, where is that actual integrated zone?
Sure.
Where does that actually happen?
Well, there is, I don't think many bass anglers are going to be upset about our Florida bass program, but I think some don't realize the extent to which the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission is working with you know, pure Florida bass and influencing genetics in, mm-hmm. in bodies of water. Jeremy, what can you tell us about the work we have done and are currently doing at Game and Fish to, in some cases, cater to the wishes of our anglers.
Yeah. Before doing so, I wanted to kind of reiterate something Sean said. And one of my opinions, what differs between Florida bass genetics and our stockings and our smallmouth bass genetics is you got to think of our smallmouth are in these natural systems and they've been there for a really long time, whereas these Florida bass are typically stocked in a man-made situation. So, you know, they've only been there.
A reservoir, yeah, for instance. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's only been 50 years. So there's differences, you know, in these smallmouth streams. They've been there forever. So, you know, we're trying to protect that. But back to the Florida bass genetics. Yeah, we've been the Black Bass Program and the Game and Fish have been working on this for some time. We're continuing to look at our largemouth bass genetics around the state to see, determine what percentage of our reservoirs have Florida bass genetics versus those that have northern bass genetics, and we're continuing to refine that, and our reservoir black bass management plan guides us on the Florida bass stockings and the process that we're going to move forward with that.
But I think it's important to note, I mean, we're stocking a lot of Florida bass in Arkansas, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it should be noted, when we talk about stocking the Florida bass, like you mentioned, we're trying to move the needle on the genetics. We're not necessarily trying to increase the number of bass in a reservoir. We're trying to shift the genetics closer to the Florida so that we can produce those bigger, faster growing fish.
And Sean, you alluded to the, you know, some work on Lake Ouachita, and I mean, the results of that are somewhat promising, correct? I mean,
this is a double-edged sword here, but yeah, you know, we've found that when it comes to integrating genetics into a body of water, we are very, very good at that. And there are a gazillion examples across the Southeast where some biologists have gone into a lake that has pure largemouth bass. They've stocked Floridas, and now almost all of the fish out there have at least some degree of Florida alleles. Okay. They're not Florida bass. Okay. They have trace amounts of Florida genetics, almost every single fish out there. Well, that's the exact same thing of what we found on Ouachita. So Ouachita was originally stocked around 2007, 2008. It was stocked with 100,000 fingerlings for 8 consecutive years. And we got out there and before we had ever stocked, and this is getting back to that weird, where's the natural integrated zone? Before Game and Fish had ever stocked Lake Ouachita, about a quarter of the fish already had some trace amounts of Florida genetics.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And you talk to anglers and they're like, oh yeah, you know, I used to go fish Lake Fork all the time. I'd catch a big one. And on my way home, you know, I'd stop by the spillway, but you know, there's a lot of that going on.
Sure.
But to be that prevalent out there, you know, 25% is pretty wild. But anyway, so we started stocking for 8 consecutive years, 100,000 fingerlings a year. We stocked all those fish out of bucktail, buckville and rabbit tail, stocked them all right there. And after 8 years, we went back, and certain areas of the lake, almost all of the fish had some Florida alleles. Okay, so we're really good at spreading the Florida alleles. But not all fish with Florida alleles are created equal, okay? You know, we've learned from our friends over there in Texas that if you want to get fish that really reach those trophy size, we're talking double digits, typically that fish is going to need at least 50% Florida alleles. And it's not like the more Florida alleles you have, you're guaranteed to reach larger sizes. There's a big growth gene, okay? And you may be a fish that has only one Florida allele, and it may be that big growth gene. And you have the potential to reach these trophy sizes. Just the more alleles that you have, the higher your probability
that you get that big growth gene. Like with people. Exactly. We're not all going to be 7-foot centers in the NBA. I mean, you know, some of us are going to be point guards.
Yeah, exactly. So what ends up happening is, and typically the sweet spot, okay, is when you have a bass that is full of largemouth, okay, then you stock a bunch of Floridas in there on top of it. Now, you're not going to stock enough Floridas for probably anyone to ever see one of those fish, which is fine because, like Jeremy said, we're not stocking Floridas to try to increase the number of fish that are in a body of water. What we're trying to do is we're trying to tap into natural reproduction. So we stock those Florida bass, and then more than likely that Florida bass is going to spawn with a largemouth. Now, when they spawn, that first generation cross is called an F1, and there are actually companies across the Southeast that sell those because they have the growth potential of a Florida, which is what we want, but they're aggressive like a Northern. So it's essentially the best of both worlds, and what that's referred to as hybrid vigor, okay? But then that F1 is more than likely going to spawn with a largemouth bass, okay? So at that point, their offspring are only going to have roughly 25% Florida alleles. And then at that point, you're no longer really tapping into that hybrid vigor, okay? So when you first start stocking a lake, there's going to be this 8 to 10 year period where you are cranking out a bunch of F1s. And a prime recent example is Chickamauga in Tennessee, right? Bunch of largemouth bass, stocked Floridas. Then there was this huge wave of F1s that were really carrying a lot of their tournament weights. And in fact, their state record is an F1 that came out of Chick, okay? And then you're going to get to the point where you no longer have the ability to produce those F1s because everything out there is this hodgepodge of hybrids.
There's going to be a dilution of the Florida genetics. Yeah, naturally.
Yeah. And, you know, again, the fish that you're stocking in there, sure, periodically someone may catch one that's really good size. But if you think about what we stock, you know, just in general, a fraction of what we stock survives. A fraction of what's naturally produced survives. But we're stocking a drop in the bucket compared to what's reproduced naturally. Then on top of that, right off the bat, some of those fish, they don't have that big growth gene. They're not going to reach trophy size. You know, then you have to further split that down because it's only the females that are going to reach. So you really whittle it down of what we're stocking to be the small percentage, right? So what you're really banking on is those F1s or when you get an F1 that will find a Florida to spawn with, and then you have what's called an FXF, which is a fish that's between 50% and 100% Florida alleles, you know?
Right.
So we're getting to the point that across the Southeast, we have these lakes that are full of these, what we're calling largemouth bass back crosses, which are fish that have some Florida alleles, but it's less than 50%.
Well, where do we go from here? What's the future of Florida bass genetics in Arkansas?
Yeah. And I mean, that's a really, really good question because where we have the greatest control, again, gets back to these game and fish lakes where we can, you can nuke a lake and then start it with Florida bass. I mean, every fish in there is a Florida.
Great example would be Atkins.
That is a prime example.
99, 2000, 2001, somewhere around the turn of the century.
It was 2000 because I was extra labor there when that happened.
Did a lot of extra labor jobs, Jeremy. You really earned your chops.
Yeah. I think that was 2000, 2001 when they drained the lake and started all over.
And then, you know, so as, you know, the 2010s, 2010s, we saw some hammers come out of
good
Atkins.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a result of exactly what you're talking about. On a roughly 1,000-acre lake that's a lot more manageable, I'm guessing, yeah, than a, you know, 40,000 acre lake.
Yeah, a little bit different story. And then, you know, you deal with a Monticello situation. That thing's going to be incredible, you know, in the next decade or so. So we have a lot of control in these smaller game and fish lakes, but on these larger core reservoirs, and this is not something that Arkansas is facing. This is something that biologists across the Southeast are starting to realize, hey, you know, we need to do something different. The days of just stock Florida bass and turn out giants, which, that being said, there are just some freak of natures out there. Prime example, Lake Fork. Lake Fork is an incredible body of water that was originally stocked with Floridas. You know, there was when they floated it, they stocked all the ponds with Florida bass. So as the lake was filling, you had nothing but Floridas out there. But in these systems where you started off with that were naturally largemouth bass reservoirs, and then you sling a bunch of Floridas in there across the Southeast, we're all kind of starting to think, okay, what is the next step here? You know?
Yeah. All right. That brings us to a great place to pivot to now. And Jeremy, I'm going to direct this to you, not because Sean isn't also an angler, but because you are the most avid angler in this room. I have no doubt about that.
You don't want any fishing advice from me. Okay. I'm gonna leave it at that.
Jeremy, if somebody's, you know, listening to this podcast and they really want to go out and let's take a couple, you know, if they want to go catch a bunch of bass or if they want to go catch a trophy bass, give us kind of some of your spots, and don't, you know, you're not allowed to keep secrets here. You are you're representing the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, not your own interest. Yeah. where are you going? Where are you going to send people?
For good fish right now, the last few weeks has been Millwood. Millwood's been spitting out some. See, 3 weekends ago, they had like 4 over 10 pounds caught in the weekend. So that's a good one. Ouachita is coming online. You know, there's 29-pound sack caught last month.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good one. Of course, Bush Holes has been showing out.
All three species up there.
Yep. Beaver should be coming online pretty quick. You know, it's seeing the benefits of the high water. You know, there's all kinds of lakes all over the Chico. Chico's a good one that we tend to forget because it's on the other side of the state. But you know, I would say right now, you know, you're in that pre-spawn. So Ouachita, central South Arkansas is going to be, you know, your best bang for your buck right now. The northern, we're still kind of in that winter we're starting to get into the pre-spawn, so they're starting to get fired up there. But I would say Millwood or Ouachita would be.
I'm going to throw a disclaimer out that we are recording this in early April, so by the time it actually, which it's only a couple of weeks out before, but. Conditions obviously changing daily, so don't hold Jeremy's feet to the fire when he says we're in pre-spawn right now, because by the time this airs, it may be spawn and in some places post-spawn. Yep. All right, how about you mentioned Monticello, Sean? That's a lake that infrastructure reasons, I guess we could say, had to be drained, and I know you Fisheries guys totally geek out when you get a blank canvas like that and get to do a lot of stuff there. But let's talk about some of those smaller lakes or game and fish lakes. Give me a handful of those, Jeremy, that you might recommend.
I think,
see, it's like you don't want to tell us. I think.
Yeah. I'll have to let Sean on that. I lean toward the big reservoirs. You know, being a tournament angler, we tend to focus on the big ones. I'm trying to think of some that would be.
I mean, lower White Oak perhaps is one.
Yeah, Erling, Columbia would be, you know, all those there.
When do you think Monticello? I grew up in southeastern Arkansas, got to fish Lake Monticello right after it was built, and it was just phenomenal for those first few years, and really for many years after. But I mean, you were hearing about double digit fish pretty much on a daily basis in the springtime, especially. How long until we start to maybe see some of those glory days restored at Lake Monticello?
So when it originally filled up, it took about 5 years to fill up. So we're probably in about the middle. You know, they're getting a bunch of rain this spring. So I would say they got several more years till it it's completely full. It has a pretty small watershed. And then,
yeah,
you know, you're going to have 7 to 10 years after that to when it's really at its peak. And I try to explain to people, you kind of put the reservoir aging like in humans, you know, that when you're a teenager in your early 20s is when you're going to be at your peak. And the same thing with reservoirs. So, you know, we got 3 years left and then it'll start ramping up. So I'd say we probably got a good 10 years before we see it really, really ramp up where we start seeing a lot of double digit fish coming out of there.
It should be fun. I just still remember some of those great days catching 4 and 5 pounders left and right. Was really, really great. Guys, it's been a lot of fun. We could go on and on talking about bass fishing. I think that's a subject that all three of us would enjoy talking about for hours, not just the 30, 45 minutes we're on this podcast. But wrapping things up, Jeremy, I want to ask you, as a guy that you've been with the Game and Fish Commission for almost 20 years, but the new kid on the block as the Black Bass Program Coordinator, what most excites you about the future of bass fishing in Arkansas?
Well, for me personally, it's just getting out and meeting more bass anglers and just being around bass anglers. I think that's the most important thing we can do is to be out there and be amongst the other anglers. And then, of course, this Reservoir Black Bass Management Plan is setting a roadmap for some excellent things to come out of that I hope that the anglers are going to see in the future and really enjoy. So just getting out there, seeing meeting with the anglers, and then trying to complete this 10-year plan that we got.
Sean, I'm going to pose the same question to you. I mean, you're not just working on bass, but you're doing a lot of habitat work with the vegetation, various projects. As you look out over the next, say, decade, what are you most excited about?
Yeah, the one thing I'm most excited about is, and you hit the nail on the head, and I know I'm becoming a little plant nerd for this, but I'm really excited to see what the future holds for our ability to do large-scale habitat in the form of something more complex, like aquatic vegetation. And, you know, if you look at reservoirs over the years, you know, we had our golden age of reservoirs. You know, of building reservoirs back in the 40s, you know, and then we went through this new reservoir phase, like what Jeremy's talking about, where there's a lot of productivity and fishing was just incredible. And then a lot of that, the natural habitat in there has degraded, and that's been reflected in the fish community. And so the kind of next phase was we've identified, hey, we've got some habitat issues here. We just need to get habitat in the lake. Just throw the kitchen sink at it. In some situations, literally, you know, just get anything out there that you can. And now we're starting to take a step back and say, okay, we are really good at putting a lot of stuff in a lake. Can we be more strategic with it? Can we put, and maybe we don't need to put 100 trees out there. Maybe we only need to put 25 trees in this one cove because this is where everything spawns, right? So you just provide immediate nursery cover and then you can see a boon there. Or maybe we just need to get a couple acres of vegetation to grow over here, and that'll have a population level effect. So for me, I think the most exciting thing is where we're headed with habitat. And this is not something that just Arkansas is taking on. This is something that the entire country is taking on. So it's really cool to kind of be opening up the creativity box here and say, okay, this is a very challenging problem. You know, we don't own the lake. There are certain things that we can do, we can't do. We're at the mercy of Mother Nature, but thinking about ways that we're going to overcome this. And, you know, just like everything, someone is going to find a solution of picking, you know, the right type of habitat or the right plant and the right method. And someone's going to find a way of really restoring on a large scale a lot of these larger reservoirs. And I think that it's going to benefit not only the fish, but the anglers in the long run.
It's exciting stuff. And we talked before actually starting the broadcast. Y'all wanted to talk about the acoustic research going on. We did not get there today. But
we didn't want to put anyone to sleep. Okay. Yeah.
It is a way to kind of study your bait fish populations. And I know that's something else that a lot of bass anglers are interested in. We've seen some decline. Grierce Ferry, a great example, yep. What, 10, 15 years ago, really, really took a nosedive. I promise we will get you back on here. to talk about the forage base and some of the research going on there. But I think we'll save that for another day.
That's a good idea.
All right. Jeremy Risley, Black Bass Program Coordinator for Arkansas Game and Fish. Sean Lusk, Staff Biologist in the Fisheries Division. Thank you all so much for coming on and enlightening us about bass.
Yeah, thanks for having us on.
Yep, thanks.
Thanks, guys. We'll talk to you next time on the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast.